Thank you very much, and welcome to the third installment of this ongoing traversal of the string quartets of Dmitri Shostakovich. Tonight, we are going to begin in 1946 with the third string quartet. Shostakovich was 40 years old at that time. And 1946 was a paradoxical time in his life. He had only recently been a great hero of the Soviet Union with his 1942 Seventh Symphony, which had established him and the symphony itself as symbols of Soviet resistance to Nazi aggression. However, in 1945, he wrote his Ninth Symphony, and this had poisoned the waters between him and Stalin, who had expected a great paean to his victory and his glorious victory over the Nazis. And he had received this rather ambiguous short Ninth Symphony, which was not what he had ordered. And so in 1946, he wrote his third string quartet, and it was viewed with a certain amount of suspicion, and it came and it went rather quickly. Like the Seventh, Eighth, and Ninth Symphonies, the third string quartet has a possibly war-related subtext and is sometimes published with actual subtitles in the program booklets. And I will read you those subtexts. The first is calm unawareness of future cataclysm, then rumblings of unrest and anticipation, then the forces of war unleashed, homage to the dead, and the eternal question, why and for what? And these are controversial because they run counter to his usual practice. He didn't like to ascribe specific meanings to his music. They don't appear in the autograph of the quartet. They don't appear in any published version of it. They can be traced to a vodka-soaked conversation that he had with a gentleman named Valentin Berlinsky, who was the Borodin String Quartet's cellist. And apparently, during that conversation, Shostakovich, or the vodka, outlined this scenario that I just described. Again, it runs counter to what he usually was like when it came to ascribing specific meanings. There is, for instance, a story about Yevgeny Bravinsky, the conductor, approaching him before the performance of the Eighth Quartet, actually the Eighth Symphony in 1943, and asking him for the meaning of the scherzo movement. And he said, the scherzo movement, it represents the functionary who has received his exit visa to the West. And from that arch, sarcastic response, we do get this sense that he preferred not to have his music viewed in such restrictive, historically related contexts. That said, these titles, if they are not valid, they do apply to a degree. And if it's not really about war, it can be heard, this third quartet, as about the tragic trajectory of a human life, starting with unsullied, innocent childhood, and going on through moments of despair and moments of conflict, and perhaps ending with ruminations about the meaning of it all. It starts in a very delightful F major, which is the key of optimism and pastoral outdoorsiness, and it is as delightful a theme as he ever wrote. Classical, rather Haydn-ish, and it seems to put us back into that carefree storybook forest that we were in the first quartet. And as we go down this path, we come upon the second character in this little drama. The first half of this piece is very conventional. It's a piece that has an exposition that repeats like an 18th century string quartet by Haydn or somebody. And then the second part becomes a little bit more peculiar. It starts the development section with that same tune, and within a few bars it slips a gear, and we end up spilling into another key all of a sudden. It's like a bit of slapstick humor. And from there, it seems like some sort of altercation erupts within the quartet. We have a moment of argumentative contrapuntal writing. But composure is quickly regained and we reestablish our equilibrium. And it ends in the same F major that it began in, only rather manic, rather madcap. There's this giddy sprint to the finish line, which sounds almost like cartoon music to me. And given the tone of the rest of this piece, I would say that that is an ironic ending, because from this high energy, lovely, optimistic F major, we ratchet down a half step into the much more serious and disconsolate key of E minor. We hear a severe E minor arpeggio in the second violin, and within a couple of bars, the first violin, as you will hear, comes barreling in a different key, and so you have this sense of rubbing together of these two different keys. And this polytonal feeling really does give us that sense of rumblings of unrest, and it comes to a culmination in the very last bars of the piece where, as you'll hear and as you will see, the cello rests finally on an E and a G, which is the lower two notes of an E minor triad, and the upper strings are clinging to a C minor chord, and so you've got in the treble an E flat versus an E natural in the bass, and this gives us this almost physically queasy feeling. If that's for me, tell them I'm busy, okay? So at this point, all of this pent-up anxiety is unleashed. It bursts, all hell breaks loose. And we have another one of these very violent, sinister scherzos. We had one of those in the eighth quartet, we had one in the tenth, and this seems like a cousin. As you will see, the measures alternate between 2-4 and 3-4, and has the sense of being some kind of a vicious military incursion. After all of this brutality, the next movement does seem a response to it. It begins with a communal expression of grief, the lower three members of the quartet playing in unison on a funeral march. And then we have individual expressions of lament and pathos, which sound like eulogies. Thank you. And he develops that initial funeral march into a passacaglia, which is to say it keeps coming back. It forms a ground under which a series of variations take place. And as we have heard in many other instances now, these passacaglias often come back later in the music. And we, even in this rather early quartet, there is this effort at unifying the material from movement to movement. And the last movement is longer than the previous movements because there's a sense of it being a compendium of what has come before. And the fourth movement begins in an eerie, rather ghostly jig between the cello with little finger snapping interjections and the viola. And they're joined then by the two violins in this eerie dance in the graveyard. And as the piece evolves, there are all kinds of contrasting interludes. We hear folk music like something out of a Mahler symphony, very delightful A major music, which again seems a little ironic in the context of all of this eeriness. This music sounds like a distant cousin, perhaps an inverted cousin of the opening music at the beginning of the piece. And this movement attains another one of these grindingly dissonant, rather convulsive climaxes, and we hear the return of that passacaglia theme that he's made out of the funeral march from the previous movement, now in a canonic setting between the cello and the viola. And at the end of the piece, we return to F major, but not that optimistic, sunny, pastoral, delightful F major from the beginning of the piece, but a much more mysterious F major. We have a sustained chord, and above it, fragments of that jig-like melody, which go way up into the stratospheric range of the first violin, and it ends with these reflective, contemplative pizzicati. From here, we will jump ahead 14 years to 1960. 1960 is the year that his first wife, Nina Varzar Shostakovich, would have turned 50 had she lived, but she didn't. They were married for 22 years, and she was the mother of his two children, Galina and Maxim. They met way back in 1927. She was beautiful and witty and charming and brilliant. She was a student at the physics school at Leningrad. She was 18 when they met, and he was about 4 years older than she and poised for greatness. And their parents apparently were not nuts about the union. They saw it as not entirely compatible. And they established marital dates, and then they postponed them. And finally, they got married in 1932. And not long after that, he met another beautiful young woman named Yelena, who was a Spanish translator and fell rather hard for her. And so a couple of years into this marriage, he asked her for a divorce. And she was not happy, but she said, all right. And then it emerged that she was pregnant. And so he made a decision and he left Yelena and he devoted himself to her and they had a second child. And they made a life together, and she stayed by him during the terrors of the 30s and his first round of denunciations after 1936 and during the war years. And in many ways, it was a marriage that worked, although it had its complications. And finally, in the 40s, she met a gentleman whom she had known during her days at the School of Physics in Lenin, in Leningrad. His name was Artyom Alekhanyan, and he had turned into one of the leading Soviet physicists in the nuclear program, had his own laboratory in Armenia, studied cosmic radiation. And he invited her to come and work with him. During the winters, she would go and spend sometimes months at a time, and they got involved. And it was not the end of the marriage. I mean, they survived it. It went along this way. Shostakovich had his own extracurricular dalliances, and they just sort of worked it out on some open basis. But finally, in December of 1954, he was at a concert. She was in Armenia. He got the distressing news that she was very sick, that she had gone into the hospital with some sort of severe intestinal blockage, and he dropped everything and ran off to Armenia to be with her. And when he arrived, she had been diagnosed as having a large stomach tumor that they didn't know about. And soon after he arrived, she died at the age of 45. And whatever complicated feelings he had about her, he was devastated, as were his children. And he fell into this period of depression, and he was unable to compose for a long time. In 56, as you may remember from the Sixth Quartet, he met a younger woman named Margarita Kainova. They got married. It was ill-fated. It didn't last long. And so when 1960 rolled around, he was by himself, despondent, a bit unprotected, and perhaps inspired by her impending, what would have been her 50th birthday, he wrote his seventh string quartet dedicated to her posthumously. And it really does have the sense of being some kind of a working out in his mind at a six-year remove of this complicated relationship. And it's the shortest of his quartets. I think it's about 11 minutes or 12 minutes in total. And the opening theme, which I think of as the Nina theme, I don't know if he thought of it that way, is anything but nostalgic and warm. It's kind of clinical, witty, and conspicuously dry-eyed. It tumbles down and it bounces three times. Kind of tender-hearted remembrance you might want of a wife of 22 years. And the second theme is similarly witty, acerbic, industrious, and lacking in warmth. And as we go through this, we hear that first theme now transformed into 3/8 pizzicato, rather conspiratorial, with it's laced with these nasty sounding barbs in the second violin. Anyway, the first movement is short. It's about 3.5 minutes long. The second movement is shorter. It's about 3 minutes long. And it is completely different. You have this austere arpeggio seesawing up and down in the second violin. And the first line in the first violin is very desolate and lamenting, and it descends almost like the brooding theme from the beginning of the Fifth Symphony. Those theremin-like glissandi, it's monster movie music. And the final movement is a bit longer, not very long in itself. And it begins with what is essentially an inversion, a reversal of the initial tumbling down theme. It rushes up urgently. Four deadpan viola notes, and it happens again. And then it just blows up in our face, and we have this scrambling, mad, frenetic fugue. And it reaches a convulsive climax where we hear the initial Nina theme, now harmonized very dissonantly and just violent. And then, as quickly as all of that chaos erupted, it dissipates. And he takes that fugue theme, and he turns it into this cool, elegant, rather diffident waltz. At the end of the piece, we hear one more iteration of the Nina theme, and it ends, rather than in F sharp minor, in F sharp major. If you buy into this notion that he's working out this relationship in his mind at a remove of 6 years, perhaps he has attained some kind of resolution. From here, we jump ahead 10 more years to 1970. And after these ruminations about this subject about which he had some ambivalence, this 22-year marriage, we have ruminations about a subject about which he has no ambivalence whatsoever, which is death. He doesn't like the idea. He's against it. He's 1969, he would be 63, and he went into the hospital for a prolonged period of time, for about a month, and that was the year before he wrote his 13th string quartet. During that stay in the hospital, he wrote his 14th symphony, which is based on poetry of Rilke and Apollinaire and Lorca, and it's all death saturated. And when he was about to have the 14th symphony premiered, he made a speech because he wanted to explain his obsession with this, and he explained his credo. He said, "Death is in store for all of us, and I, for one, do not see any good in the end of our lives. Death is terrifying. There's nothing beyond it. I don't believe in life beyond the grave." So that was his bleak assessment. This piece, this death-saturated 13th quartet, is in one long movement. There's no fast parts of it. There's no scrambling fugues. And it is dedicated to the violist of the Beethoven quartet, Vadim Boris Sofsky. He had actually retired in 64, but I guess he felt he owed him a quartet. And he was a brilliant violist. He was not only the violist of the Beethoven quartet, He was the principal violist of the Bolshoi Theater Orchestra, the teacher at the conservatory in Moscow, and no less a violist than Paul Hindemith said that he was the chairman of the World Union of Violists. And so this dark, melancholy viola protagonist is the central voice in the 13th quartet. It begins, as did the 12th quartet, with a tone row, which is to say that it covers 12 notes, it covers all 12 notes of the chromatic scale. And yet it has a different quality than the 12th quartet, which begins in the cello. This one, of course, begins in the viola. And it outlines B flat minor, which is a very dark key in string playing. And as you will hear, it is full of half steps, these close intervals. They are descending, they are lamenting, it's full of melancholy. You will hear about four of them in this opening row. That's one. That's another. From here, the whole first section is based on these descending, lamenting sighs or groans, and it culminates in a simultaneous half step, which is almost physically painful to listen to. Digression. If you were at the overview lecture about a week and a half ago, I mentioned that in 1929 he started working with a film director named Grigory Kozintsev. He wrote the music for a film called The New Babylon. Now, 40 years later, he's still working with him, and he did the film score for a wonderful movie about King Lear. And after the storm scene, there is a lamenting, wordless choir, which you may recognize. Another example of self-quotation, which we heard reach its culmination in the 8th quartet in the last concert. And as we move through this single movement, we come to another example of these three notes repeated, bup, bup, bup. We heard that in the 8th quartet in the 4th movement with those loud crunching noises, which may represent the knocking of fate or the KGB or the Gestapo. We heard them in the Nina theme, la da bup, bi da bup, bi da bup, bup, bup. We hear them here. Rather delicate at first, but they build to dissonant climax. They sound like karate chops. And he parlays this into what I think is the strangest section of any of his quartets. Eugene Drecker, one of the violinists of the Emerson Quartet, calls it the jam session from hell. Does sound like a skeleton bebop combo with that walking bass and the cello and those odd clicking noises that permeate this movement here produced by the viola by knocking his bow against the back of the instrument. Hard to know what that represents, maybe death rattles. I was thinking about that because it rang a bell, and I remembered that in the 14th symphony that he wrote just before this in the seventh movement, he produces that same clicking noise on the woodblock, and the texture is similarly pizzicato and slightly jazzy. It's like a slow motion cousin of this section. This piece is similarly unusual and out of the ordinary, especially for Shostakovich, where so many of his quartets end morendo, that word dying away. In this case, the viola has a cadenza at the very end, and he climbs out of his range and way up into the violin range, and then almost out of the violin range, up to a super high B flat. He nestles up there and is joined by the second and the first violin. And together they make this huge crescendo to four fortes, and then it just jumps off into the abyss. It stops like it's been sliced off by a guillotine blade. Literally chilling music, terrifying. And I kept thinking, this reminds me of something, and then I remembered from my years at the Met. The end of, I think it's scene two from act three of Wozzeck. Wozzeck kills his common law wife, Marie. And we hear a similar gesture in the orchestra itself, which this may be a reference to. You know, you can cover your ears. He loved Wozzeck. He heard it first about 50 years before when it was premiered in Petrograd in the early 1920s. And the final piece on the program is the 14th quartet, this penultimate quartet, composed in 1973. And by this time, he was getting quite old. He was only 67 at the time, but he looks much older than that. His health was bad. He was in and out of the hospital. And after his 15th symphony, he had fallen into another one of these periods where he was unable to write. He was just depressed and physically ill at ease. And he wrote to his friend Isaac Glickman, the theater critic up in Leningrad, and he said, "I'm almost helpless in all daily matters. I'm unable to dress or wash myself independently. It's as if some spring has broken inside of me. Since finishing the 15th symphony, I haven't composed a single note. So he was clearly depressed. And he received a visit about that time from Yevgeny Bravinsky, the conductor who had premiered the 15th symphony. And he complained about his condition and his lack of creativity and his physical problems. And then he said, you know, the doctors will not even let me have a drink. Can you imagine that? And then he said, what the hell, let's have a drink. And so they shared a vodka. And the next morning he got up and started to write his 14th string quartet. What can we learn from this story? Anyway, the 14th quartet is completely different than the 13th. There are none of these tone rows wafting through the piece. It is perhaps inspired by the much more jovial personality of Sergei Sharinsky, who was the remaining member of the Beethoven quartet to whom he had not, at that time, dedicated a quartet. And Sharinsky was the most accessible member of the quartet, zestful and good-humored and very Russian in his heartiness and married three times and five children and all the rest. And the thought of him seems to have cheered him up considerably. And when he was finished with the 14th quartet, he invited the quartet members to come over and to read it through. And it turned out that Sharinsky's half-brother, Vasily Sharinsky, was the second violinist who had died back in 65. He had been replaced by another gentleman who was sick that day. So Shostakovich volunteered to play the second violin part on the piano as best as he could. And at the end of that run-through, he said, my friends, this has been one of the happiest moments of my life. Because, first of all, I think the quartet has turned out very well. And secondly, because I have the good fortune to play with the Beethoven quartet, if only with one finger. And so, as you will hear, it occupies a completely different musical landscape than the 13th quartet. It begins with this jovial cello of Sergei Sharinsky, very Russian, very exuberant. The second theme is similarly cello-centric. It's a more lyrical theme. As we move through this piece, you will notice more of these spare textures, where you hear one instrument or a duet between two instruments. This becomes a feature of his late music. After the first lecture, I was speaking with a gentleman who I think was a neurologist, and he had said perhaps the polio, which was causing him so much trouble to write, was influencing these sparer textures. Perhaps so. Later in this movement, there's a viola solo, which starts in D minor. It's based on that same second theme. And he called it the Chaconne because of its association, D minor and the piece by Bach. And the return to that jovial Sharinsky theme. Another feature of this piece that really separates it from all of the other late quartets is the presence of very sweet, nostalgic music. Here's an example. Here we have the cello way up in its upper register, accompanied in guitar-like pizzicati by the other instruments. Thank you, David Finkel, wherever you are out there. And later we have a duet between the high cello and the low first violin, which would have been played by Sharinsky and by Dmitri Tsiganov, and they were the two remaining members of the original Beethoven quartet. And again, it is nostalgic to the point of being almost maudlin. He called it my Italian bit. Context, we might almost hear this as ironic or sardonic, but I don't think so. I think here it's genuine affection and nostalgia for this gentleman with whom he had been associated for 50 years at this point, these two gentlemen, in fact. And later on, this affection is expressed in one of these cryptographic renditions of Sergei's name. He uses the familiar form Seryozha, and he finds a way to encrypt it by the use of German and solfège and Cyrillic. I mean, you have to really think about it to figure it out. But here's how it sounds, again with these three repeated notes. As if to make sure that Seryozha is getting the joke, he puns on his name, Seryozha, my darling, Horoshimoi, from the end of Lady Macbeth of Butsensk. Finally, at the end, we hear the return of that little Italian bit, that Italian serenade, and it ends with the cello way up at the top. So this penultimate quartet ends not in that bleak, austere, death-saturated world of the 13th quartet, but in this rather resigned and affectionate remembrance in this mood of acceptance of the inevitable, which is a relief. So anyway, enjoy the concert tonight.